Hey, welcome to this week's episode. My name is June.
And I'm Christine. Let's get ready to rock your biz.
All right, so check this out. We did a viewer mail segment on this a while back. Someone just asked, like, hey, you guys are the host of the show, but like, what do you guys do like during the day? And we talked a little bit about, because we don't have so much time, you know, and that kind of stuff. But so want to dedicate at least an episode each to really talk about kind of the background of what we do, or it's kind of what we do nowadays. It's not like when I was five, I wanted to be an entrepreneur or something like that. But to just kind of give you an idea of where our advice is coming from, I think what we're hearing back from a lot of viewers is that, you know, our advice comes across a little differently because we're like real life breathing entrepreneurs. We're not like 60 years old and like, back in the day, you know, you should really use print advertising and this new thing called magazines, you know, like, so we're like, you know, tried and true entrepreneurs right now doing business. We've had a fair amount of success and we just felt like we're in an advisory role with so many people, and that was why we started our show. So this week's episode, we want to talk to specifically you, Christine, about kind of what you're doing nowadays. So let's start from like, you know, you're running Social Starfish, a successful social media company. And then all of a sudden, I don't think, like, I don't know when it was, a couple months ago, you're like, you know, hey, June, I'm going to start this, like, luxury day spa. And you're like, that's cool. So what's up with that? Like, so let's talk about that transition a little bit.
I know. And so many, I mean, it was just at a networking event last night, and they were just like, wait, what are you doing now? Wait, what? Right. Or like, how's Social Starfish doing? I'm like, oh, no. I move really fast.
You're like, that's going great, but that's not really the whole question. Like, I'm not really doing that anymore. Yeah.
And I'm like, I move so fast, it's hard to keep up, I guess. But I'm just, my why in life is to, and it took years to figure this out, I don't know why, mm-hmm. but is to start a business from scratch, just some crazy ideas. I've had some crazy ones, and they've all worked out somehow, but, and just build it, and then get it all systematized and running and good to go, and then go to the next.
Right.
Just, I get bored.
Once you're not creating like babies. They're like, this is my lifelong job.
I want to
do. Which is, I mean, that's what most entrepreneurs actually do.
Right. Which is fine. That's just not my personality type. I don't ever create a company. Even back in the day with Cleanology, I didn't say, oh, I'm going to have this company forever. No. Right. I knew I wouldn't have it forever, but I never know, because that's everybody's next question. Well, how long are you going to have this company for? I have no idea.
Is it how you feel, or is there like numbers you have in mind?
No,
or like
how it's how like, I feel. Yeah, it's like, to me, if the passion's gone, and that was Cleanology, you know, that one at 5-year mark, exactly on the 5-year mark, it was like the 5-year itch. I was just like, I woke up, I'm just like not excited to go to work Monday. Like, it's time to sell. It's not fair to the team. It's not fair to the clients.
Sure.
It's not fair to, if you lose your passion as the leader, it's not fair to everybody else.
Right.
And they won't have any passion.
So how long did it take you to stop feeling bad about being a serial entrepreneur?
It was not until literally it was not maybe a few months ago, because they're like, really, you're gonna start another business? You're crazy.
And oftentimes family and friends, they do that a little bit too, like, hey, Christine, we're a little worried. And people do that with serial entrepreneurship. They're like, I don't get it, I thought you were doing this, you know, like,
I know. Or they think that
you dove into that so much, so like, what's wrong with your personality that you're schizophrenic?
No, I know, right? Neurotic, schizophrenic. I'm crazy. I started taking that personally. A lot of people are like, oh my God, you're so crazy. But actually now I take it as a compliment. I'm like, you're right, I am crazy. And I think it takes a crazy person to start things, build them. I mean, all six, this is my seventh. Eco Chateau will be my seventh business. The other six are still in business to this day.
Which that's a big difference between like, I went from failed venture to failed venture to failed venture, you know?
Yeah, I got perfect track record. Right. Lucky number seven. Right. So I got to keep all of it together, but I don't need that. But my why in life is to create jobs.
Right.
So, and revenue for the economy. So someone's got to get this economy back up and running, and if that's got to be me, that's got to be me. I'm fine with that. But my big monster goal in life, I finally put a number on it. It's $100 million in annual revenues between all the companies I create.
Right.
So right now we're at $2 million. If you add the six together, they're doing about $2 million annually.
Right.
I finally put a number. I go, let me put a number on this.
That's cool.
I always feel like you need to be specific with your big life
goal. Yeah.
And I know, and it's weird. I mean, it's not like I want $100 million. I just think it's cool to create things and create jobs. And imagine how many people that'll impact.
Yeah, so think about it. It's kind of like it's your own customized kind of version of, like, you know, if you look at the Virgin business empire, right? It's funny because none of those are the top. They're all like number six or seven in their individual industries. But they're all like top 10. And there's like 27 things underneath the Virgin Empire. You know, there's all these different, there's some that we know about, you know, popular and stuff.
There's about 200 total.
Oh, is there 200
there's
total?
200. Okay. Yeah, but they're probably small.
We probably know about five of them.
Yeah.
You know, off of, anyone's gonna know that kind of stuff. But it's really great that I think, you know, what you said is like, you don't mind being crazy. I mean, if crazy means unusual, that's what people mean, you know? Yeah, entrepreneurs, we're a different breed. And I love the fact that you can be honest with the fact that just until recently, you're like, you know what? I'm okay with being this unusual.
Yeah, you know, yeah. I finally realized that my job is creating businesses from scratch, building them, selling them, moving to the next. Like, it's some people flip houses. I flip businesses.
Right.
That's what I like to say. Yeah. That's the best way to. And now everybody's like, oh, that's really cool. When before, they couldn't understand it.
Right. And is that because you were able to now explain it better?
Yeah, I think that helped. Yeah. That helped.
So you're like, I'm not crazy. This is why I do this.
And yeah,
like,
this is what I do. Okay. But now I'm trying to design a business card because I have so many business cards. I don't, you know.
That is actually the downfall of being a serial entrepreneur.
Yeah, because it's a different business card, a different email address. Yeah. Everyone's like, does Christine's Social Starfish still work? And I'm like, yeah. I'm not like trashing the email address. Right. But I almost need like a generic permanent one.
Right, and I wonder, I never got the chance to see it, but like, you know, you look in most MBA programs, will when they talk about serial entrepreneurship or the different types of entrepreneurship, one of the classic case studies used is easily the most famous serial entrepreneur that anyone knows of is a guy named Roger Rees, R-E-I-S-S is his last name. And I think finally before he like retired, they asked him to like write a book. And so they actually assigned some dude to interview him and some gal wrote the book. But this guy, I mean, he would go in and out of deals, basically 18 to 24 months was kind of his window. And his whole life, it's just been him and his full-time secretary. And that's all that's been in his company.
Wow.
And he pulls together deals.
Yeah.
And you know, the secretary is still typing stuff out. You know, the day he died, you know, he retired, he's still alive. They would, you know, her job was to do all the correspondence. He would bring all the relationships together and the ideas, and then, you know, every 18 to 24 months, he's walking out with a whole bunch of cash from a company that started from nothing that only had a shelf life for a couple years anyways, you know?
Nice.
And he's like legendary because in MBA case studies, because he thinks so differently, you know, than the average MBA kind of grad, they use him all the time for cases like, here's what's going on in this business. We're gonna stop right here. What would you do? And then they go on and tell about what Roger Rees did, which he did something that, you know, no one else would have done, kind of stuff. So it's really cool.
I love that.
I haven't followed up to see if they actually finished that book, but I remember seeing a Wall Street Journal article saying he's finally officially hanging it up. But I'm curious, like, what his business card would say if it just said entrepreneur, and just had the phone number for the lady, and an email for that lady. That's pretty much it. You know, it's like this. And I can imagine he's just like in this office, and there's nothing, there's no sign or anything.
Yeah,
it's just him and the gal.
Hanging out. What's the email
address? Now, you had mentioned something like with Cleanology, your cleaning business, it was kind of an upscale kind of demographic that you were working with. Mm-hmm. And that specifically when you're choosing the next business to get into, it was kind of the luxury spa was attractive because the demographic was really fun to work with.
Yes, I loved working with the affluent. I love it. I prefer it. You know, people say, oh, they're so picky. Oh, they're so hard to deal with. I don't care. I love it. I honestly prefer that.
They're picky because they will pay for stuff of high quality.
Exactly.
Right?
So
and
I think
they will pay for it.
Yeah.
I want
to step up our game.
Right.
So I'm willing to provide that. Like, it needs to be top notch. Whatever I build needs
to
be.
It's probably
that.
Not going to be. Their standards aren't really that different than your own standards for what you wanted to put
some
out there.
I don't know. I'm not that picky. But regardless, building things, I want to make the pickiest person in the world happy.
Yeah.
So I don't. When I get a complaint, I'm not like, oh my gosh, why are they complaining? They're so picky. I'm like, okay, what can we do to make this person happy?
Mm-hmm.
Because if we can make the pickiest person happy, then we can make everybody happy.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I don't mind that one bit. So I definitely knew I wanted to do B2C, meaning business to consumer.
Right.
Again.
Right.
I wanted to deal with the affluent.
And that was something you learned by doing Social Starfish, which is more B2B.
B2B.
It had pros and cons and different kinds of
business.
Yeah,
and the biggest con is that, you know, business owner, and I don't know, maybe we've talked about it on a prior show, so I apologize if we did, if you're hearing this again, but they decide, a business owner makes a decision based on logic, right? And on a return on investment.
Right.
So they're gonna crunch numbers, and it's strictly usually based on that. A consumer based their decision on emotion. So that's a lot easier.
Right.
You know, and they're willing to pay anything for it.
Right.
A business owner's not.
Right.
I would say
business owners still, they end up initially being interested because of emotion. The way they rationalize it is the numbers.
Because
if I don't like you, I don't trust you, I don't care what the numbers say, I'm not going to do business with you.
Yeah.
That's an emotional state still.
That's
right.
But then when it pencils out.
Because you're saying you missed that. And that makes sense. Like, I always try to advise our clients, especially if they're doing retail B2C, I always say, hey, shoot for the luxury position in your industry. And they're always like, that's the best place to be.
Yes.
You know, because you can roll out lower tier services. It's like, you know, like people go to like the Nordstrom's or whatever, like a Nordstrom's, but then they'll go to an outlet. only because they know what the real Nordstrom's is. Yeah. And so they're willing to go to outlet for it. So Nordstrom still has an outlet store, but you know, they're the luxury brand for the industry. So I was thinking that's really smart. I was really excited when you said you want to do that. And then you also said, though, and this gives you kind of some of the clues to how Christine works, and she's a very passion-driven person, is that the luxury spa ended up being on your radar because you saw the value for yourself. Like, hey, I need to take time to take care of myself as an entrepreneur. Mm-hmm. No one else's job is to take care of you. It's all of our jobs as an entrepreneur to get enough sleep and health and rest and, you know, all that kind of stuff,
like,
right?
Like, you're laughing at my 9 hours.
Yeah, exactly. 9 hours of sleep, 3 hours of sleep. I'm working. So hopefully it doesn't show up in the show quality. But you guys actually seen the value in your own life. And you're like, well, I think I could convince other people like myself of the value of this.
Yeah. Right. Well, it was the marathon. It wasn't so much getting spa treatments. It's training for a marathon for 4 months earlier this year. And everyone's like, oh my God, how are you going to fit that in your crazy schedule? Right. And I was so much more productive. Right. I've said it before. It was weird, actually. And that was a wellness thing. It was because I was taking care of myself. Mm-hmm. I'm the leader of this team. So, and we run ourselves into the ground. And so if I'm not well, my company's not well, and everything was crappy. And then, but I got well and started eating differently. So it's that whole wellness thing. And then now I've left middle of the day for a massage. I come back and I'm just like cranking through things. Like,
so viewers, crazy. You can just use the last 45 seconds of what you said. Use it for any kind of marketing copy you want. It's like perfect the way you said that. But also the cool thing, you know, especially luxury spa stuff. And I'm like, man, I should have done this too. It's like anytime you now go to a luxury spa or resort,
write-off.
It's like a straight-up write-off. Because it's like market research and quality.
I was at La Costa all last Friday all day long. La Costa Spa.
That's
awesome. I was like,
I would like one of all those drinks.
I know,
we just need to see how it works.
Every single treatment all day long. Which they were incredible. I must say, they were incredible. I got some amazing.
You like the new
ideas.
Renovations and stuff?
Yeah.
I was
I've
like,
never been there before.
Oh, okay.
I've never been there.
Yeah.
But yeah, I heard they did some insane.
Yeah, I've been there years ago, but through the university club, we were doing some meeting over there. And I couldn't stay for all the, they were giving us all complimentary tours and treatments and stuff. And I was like, crap, I have like someone's birthday party I need to go to. I'm like, you know.
No.
But yeah, the renovations were phenomenal. Yeah. They just did a really good job.
They did a great job. And so, yeah, essentially what I look for in an industry that I want to jump into and help is I just see things missing. So every time I get a facial or massage, there's never been a time where I went and I was like blown away. Mm. Two times out of all the facials I've ever had, has the esthetician called me the next day, how's your skin doing? Two times, that is it.
Out of like 100 or something?
I'm not saying they need to do that every time.
Right.
But at least after your first
time. I get massages all the time and like, there's very little follow-up.
No,
like,
there's no
you guys
follow-up.
Suck. What's
no
what's
follow-up.
It's a competitive industry.
Yes.
It's even commoditized to some extent.
Yeah.
Why aren't you guys following? How hard is that?
No, they don't even get your info. When I walk in, I'm like waiting to give my email and stuff and they don't ask for my email address. I'm like, okay. Or phone number. I'm like, so they can't follow up with me. But so little things like that, it's like, I just want to create this experience. I love creating experiences. So I love getting an industry that I know, oh my gosh, I can create this magical experience that nobody else is doing. Come on, guys. I know there's a zillion massage places out there and everybody likes to remind me right now. And I'm like, duh. Like,
I know there is,
you guys. They're like, oh my gosh, there's so many.
Right.
I know there's
But you're building a better mousetrap. I mean, you're just doing a couple of things here and there that they're not going to be able to pull together your competition.
Yeah.
And it's only going to be a matter of time before that ends up being out all the competitive stuff. So you had, you know, let's just talk your most recent adventures. So like your Cleanology cleaning services company and then like Social Starfish. How have those affected the way you started up those and what you learned from that? How has that uniquely affected the startup for this Eco Chateau luxury day spa?
This one's really different because it's a build out. So out of all the businesses, they were all service businesses. And of course we had offices and whatnot, but we never built out a physical location. So this is, it's fun though. I love it.
Right. Like, and it was kind of a hitch early on. Like, you know, the landlord wanted to do the build out for you, but they didn't know if they could.
The plumbing,
swing it.
Plumbing got declined. Yeah. They didn't want to put, it was like 10 grand worth of plumbing. So they, and then I talked them in with my persistence. I got another unit in that same building that worked better for the plumbing. So, but I mean, what do I know? What's the same? To be honest, now somebody brilliantly pointed out, Christine, why don't you keep systematizing these companies that you build? Which I do. I will have an operations manual that a 10-year-old could come in and run these companies.
Right.
But he's like, you've never systematized the system of starting a business. And I'm like, duh.
If this is what you're going to do for a while, that's actually what business you're in.
Yeah,
right, that's what he said.
He goes, that's your business. What are you doing? So he goes, you need to document it all, which luckily I already was. So I'm like, okay, but I need to like make a manual where it's like step one, file a fictitious business name.
Right.
Step two, because people were offering me money. We're pre-selling VIP packages and people whipped out their credit card and I was like, I don't even have a bank account or PayPal or Square. And I was like, crap, you know, like there does need to be a certain order.
All of you listening to the show, you all need to have a Square reader right now. It's free. The reader comes in. Square just got, Starbucks as their major client, right?
Yep.
And their investor, they're on the board as well.
And they got the cool register, which we're going to have.
That's only like 7,000 new clients that Square just picked up. But like, you know, I have a Square reader in my backpack. So at any point in time, if someone wants to give me money, pull up my phone, boom.
2.75,
I met a guy that owed me money. Like, I met a guy that owed me money. And we were just shooting the breeze. And I'm like, hey, man. And he's like, hey, I feel bad. I still owe you like 150 bucks. I'm like, yeah, you do. You know, now you're going to get some percentage fees taken off.
Yeah.
But I was like, hey, you have a credit card on you now, a debit card? He's like, oh, yeah. I'm like, great. Let's go. And he's like, oh, wow. You know, it was kind of a weird.
Or even dinners where people are like trying to chip in and they don't have cash. It's like, okay. I mean, again, you're paying.
You're like,
but you can
charge it. I'm like, I'm going to charge you convenience fee of 5%. I'm going to make a little bit off of this transaction.
So no Square. Yeah, right. We got it all dialed in now.
Cool.
We got it dialed in. We can take money now.
Yeah, there's no excuse for you. I mean, just have your money set up. And then Square, you can always divert. You can always make the receipt say something different. So even if you don't have your bank account set up yet, you can still make the receipt say that business while you're figuring all that out. Because Square will let you hold the money and then you could divert it wherever you want to go.
Yeah.
You know, because there's no reason to not be able to take money.
Exactly.
From people,
My social starfish, I got bought out majority of it. I still own a percentage. Yep. And my business partner was none too pleased that I've been swiping $400, $1,200. He's like, you know, that's income and I'm going to have to pay taxes on that, right? Yeah. I'm like, really? Okay, sorry. Just let me know what I owe.
I know, exactly.
He's like, it looks like my income, but it's your income. You know, because I'm like, crap, I was like, okay, let me fix this.
Yeah. Now, what other unique challenges? I mean, so there's a build out because of the physical location.
Mm-hmm.
What other, I mean, you put a lot of time. You did all like you put together a branding project. You just were telling me that you just mapped out the tree for all your sales process for the online
marketing
kind of stuff. So what other unique challenges came up with this, specifically like luxury day spa?
What kind
of research that was like maybe new for you to do? Or
the hardest part was projections, and that, so I get really crazy and geek out on
that's understandable. Yeah.
So how do you project income for an industry that you've never been in? A. Mm-hmm. B, it's a brand new business. So, and that I do struggle with. Even every business I've struggled because it's brand spanking new. Like I literally had to pull numbers out of the sky, but like think, okay, is this logical? What can we sell an average of one massage a day, 30 in a month, out the gate? If I'm pre-marketing for a month, and at my network.
If you're pre-marketing, the answer is yes. If you're not pre-marketing, the answer is no.
magically
the answer is no.
So, but again, it's like that was probably that's been the hardest. And I can fix when I do projections. I'm great at projecting a company that's already running, so I can easily project
because you have some historical.
Yeah,
and you go,
yeah,
if I infuse
history.
My marketing. This much, it'll grow this much.
Yeah. That's really easy. But yeah, from scratch, I was like, oh my gosh, and this thing, yeah. So I mean, it'll be the first month and I can tweak it and then follow it.
Right. When I do business planning courses, we just always say like, you know, entrepreneurs, we're visionary, positive people, or else we wouldn't be doing stuff. I always say, so for entrepreneurs, when we're doing financial projections, especially for a brand new venture, the thing I always say is be as conservative as possible. Because if you're doing a business plan, think about it. There's really only three reasons to do a business plan. One is you're trying to get funding. Like you're trying to, you know, get a loan of some kind. So that person is a super conservative person across the desk from me. They need to see super conservative numbers. Mm-hmm. Like, are you really going to be able to get one a day? I mean, that's what they're going to ask, right?
Yeah.
The second reason you do a business plan is if you're trying to get contracts, like you're trying to be a vendor for like Costco, you know, or you're trying to be a vendor. They want to see a business plan, but that business plan is still needs to be conservative, but that's more about your operation, your ability to scale. That's what they want to see. The third reason, the only other reason you do a business plan is for yourself to keep track of, like to map out your success and stuff like that. And at that point, the financials can be a little more rosy, rose-colored and whatnot, but they should still always like, because this is your livelihood on the line, always be as conservative as possible. Say like, okay, in my worst day, how much can I sell? Like absolutely my worst day, you know, marketing flubs and everything, can I still land one a day? Yeah, I can. right? And then you can put that in there. But that's what we always recommend when we're doing that kind of stuff from scratch, you know?
And that's really tricky for me because, to be honest, I look at it a different way. I was conservative, but I'm like, I'm going to set these numbers, and I'm going to do whatever it takes to hit the numbers. So that's my, and right. They weren't crazy. They right. were conservative. Right. But then anybody else sees them, and they think they're not. But yeah, in my head, I'm like, I'll just do whatever it takes.
Right, right.
Like, we are hitting these numbers. Like, no exactly. ands, ifs, or buts. Right. I'll do whatever it takes.
Yeah, so when I do financial projections, I have like, okay, this is what I know I could do. I could do with half a brain and like one leg missing. I can land this much business.
Okay.
But this is my project. This is what my goal. What I want to do. But if that bare bones, like I'm half dead. If that's not feasible, then I think it's not a good business, right?
Yeah.
So that's just, you know, we recommend that way. So now you do all that. You got these unique challenges, and you know, we're just showing you guys behind the scenes kind of stuff. So you have like a two part. Let's talk a little bit about the pre-marketing. You have a two-part grand opening coming up.
Yes.
Right?
So our awesome VIP packages that we put together, it's like $4,700 worth of spa treatments it's an annual membership for $1,200, right? So these people are prepaying before we even open the door. Like, we're not offering, it's going to be $1,900. The day we open the door, that package is $1,900.
Right. You got to hold that integrity.
Yeah, no, and I will. I'm like, and people have said, and I'm like, no.
And you're like, no.
I am not making this up. You guys, it will never be this cheap in the history of my company. I promise you that. Because these people are doing it in advance prior to even us opening. And so I wanted to do a private party for them. So the VIPs only, and it's going to be amazing networking. I mean, a lot of these are business owners or, you know, pretty big people in the community. Mm-hmm. So we're going to have a really great, intimate VIP only party about 2-3 weeks after we open, a couple weeks after we open.
Right.
So they get, you know, they get to enjoy the party before the grand opening, which will be 10 days later. So that's everybody.
Now think about it. There's a couple really, really cool things that you do. So one is, you're using that VIP thing to pre-sell your, like you're gonna, from the day you open, you're already got cash flow.
Yeah.
Right, so that's like super smart. So for all of you viewers, you gotta, no matter what you're doing, figure out you gotta be marketing before it actually happens. This is how you prepare for a launch, you know? And then you're doing, you know, and then the VIPs are getting the insider track, but then they're also, there's another opportunity for them to be publicly recognized as VIPs.
We are having a plaque in the location. Yeah. I don't know exactly where, but their name is going on a plaque as the founding members of the spa.
How cool is that?
Yeah, because you're right. I mean, they're helping cash flow and they're helping with the actual build out. I mean, those funds are helping launch the business.
I'm a VIP, and I know I had my great VIP reception just for me, and realized it was awesome. And then now you're telling me during that time of what the actual launch is going to be, like the actual grand opening for the general public, that I'm more apt to say, you know what? One, you're going to recognize me as a VIP there.
Yeah.
So I'm going to invite, you know, some friends. But also, it's such a great experience. I do actually want other people to experience this as well. So it's also another form of marketing. That's like third-party credibility, viral stuff. It's great. It's a real genius thing.
No.
Now, just as for you cues as like entrepreneur lifestyle stuff, it's very important to us, like life balance and whatnot. You're doing a really smart thing before all the grand opening activities happen. You're like, you're taking off.
Oh, yeah. You know? I know, I told him we were trying to book like when we would film again.
Right.
And I was like, okay, well, just FYI, I'm leaving for like 7 or 8 days. I'm going to South Florida.
Right.
Because if I don't take a vacation right now, I'm not getting one.
When's it going to happen?
Oh,
right?
It won't happen.
Because you don't know when the next chance to come above water for air and stuff like that.
I have to be realistic. I mean, I'm going to be there a lot. And Adopt a Christmas Tree launching
Which
simultaneously.
Is seasonal every...
Yeah.
So that's the thing is like, that's such a smart move. And this is why this comes to my next thing. It's like, you have a very interesting side business. It's so interesting. You guys might not know this. I think you talk about a little bit in your bio on the show is that because you're a serial entrepreneur, you never necessarily like you have a coaching business, but people are like, hey, Christine, you're like obviously a real life, like successful, you know, true entrepreneur. Like, can I pay you to give me some advice and stuff like that? So you have like this like interesting, like almost informal, like just coaching business that comes along, you know? So talk a little bit about like, you know.
Well, I'm definitely not taking clients right now
in the middle
of a launch, but so I do refer them to this show, which is great. Or if a client doesn't want to pay my rate, it's like, you know what? And they're just starting out.
Right. Yeah.
Like,
we have five episodes on that. Go check it out.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. Yeah. I mean, it's like, just watch the show.
Hey, we love our shows, man. We watch our own shows and go, that is some great stuff, Christine and June. Let me do that tomorrow. It's great.
Yeah. So I just, Yeah, I do. I love. I mean, that's my business is my passion. Everybody knows right. that. Marketing right. and business.
And you naturally tend to fall into like a mentor role because you feel like people have mentored you and we're never,
You know, so all that kind of stuff. Always help. Like, so I'll donate, but I've been crazy booked out. Like, once a week, I'll do an hour. I'll just donate. If somebody's really hard on their luck, they're just starting out, they don't want to pay my rate. It's like, okay, I'll, donate some time and do that, but and help them out. But yeah, right now I'm like closed down. Like I'm like, okay, let me get this business off the ground. Give me a couple months. I can't do any type of coaching. But yeah, no, I do offer that. Love speaking at events. Mm-hmm. Do that.
Right. Also. So here's kind of the cool thing about all of you guys. Like, if you are really good at what you do, there is some side revenue to be made for people to just say like, oh, hey, could I, for me it's usually people like, hey, can I take you out to lunch? And I'm like, well, I'm not really, I don't like need free lunches necessarily, but I would say, well, what's behind your question? Like, well, I have these questions, blah, blah, blah. Well, you can either buy formal time for me, check out our show, or, if you want to buy me lunch, let me choose the place. And we're going to have like a 2 or 3 hour conversation or whatnot. But, there's a whole side thing. If you're really good at anything, it's kind of what we talk about our niche conversation. If you're really good at something, people want to like be mentored or get formal advice. I get paid little chunks here and there. People just like, hey, can you sit in this meeting for 2 hours? And afterwards, tell me what you see. I'm like, you're really paying me to observe your team? He's like, yeah, because you can observe a team and know what's going on. I'm like, absolutely. I can tell within 10 minutes what's going on here and what's sabotaging your team. But it's really interesting that there's a side business always you've made. Now, the flip side of that is that if you're someone like Christina and I and you're always wanting to get better, you'd be surprised how many people are so approachable if you just say, hey, listen, like, I really respect you and I don't have anything common, maybe in an industry. But I really like the way you're doing stuff. Mm-hmm. Could I just pick your brain a little bit? People are so open to doing that. And if they're not, screw them. right? Those aren't people you want to learn from anyways.
Yeah.
That kind of stuff.
See if that they can help. Yeah. But I do ask now, because I've spent a lot of time with people that are wanting to start a business, I actually ask for a business plan now. If I'm going to do free time with a friend, it's like, I'm sorry, I need a business plan. Because, you spend all this time with them and then they don't take any action. So I'm like, okay, if at least I know they're serious.
They've got to qualify, at least started a business plan.
Yeah.
So definitely for me, I mean, I always want people to know, this is my hourly rate, just so you know.
Yeah.
This is my hourly rate. Now, I'm not going to charge you that because of this or that or the other, right? Or I am, I'm going to do a partial, or we're going to do an installment plan, whatever, right? Usually what happens if it's this young, like a brand new startup person, we're charging them for like 1 hour and we're giving them like 5 hours for the time and all this kind of stuff. But they've got to do they've got to qualify by doing something.
Yeah.
They've got to show me, like you said, that this is going to be a win-win for all of us,
Because they won't take action. I mean, people put free, the value in free is zero. There's zero value. If somebody pays money, then they have more of a, they actually feel like, okay, well, I paid them, I'm going to take action on this.
And the reality is, like you said, like one of the things that we love, I mean, there's a why. We love doing things for the reason we do entrepreneurship. So for us, it's not so much the money, but like if I'm carving out time to help out an entrepreneur, I'm going to be paid by the satisfaction that they're doing well in their business. So it's just a way to kind of qualify that.
Yeah,
say like,
true.
That's the way we get paid. Because that's the kind of like one thing that motivates us. So real quick, before we end, what other kind of things can you vision the next couple of years, things in the pipeline of any other new businesses or whatever?
That's everybody's other question. Yeah. They always ask that. I never know what the next venture is going to be.
Right.
I don't know.
Well, we do know because we're doing stuff on the show. We might do some kind of training stuff.
Oh, yeah.
That kind of stuff.
Yeah, no,
we'll
that would
see.
Be awesome. Yeah. Maybe a big event and do something live.
Yeah, absolutely.
For this, but,
hey, so that's all for this week. Hopefully you've enjoyed picking the brain of the brilliant Christine McDannell.
Nice.
If you're in San Diego, Eco Chateau, you got to, if you're here just for a couple hours even, you got to make this as part of your trip. If you're here for the grand opening, that's great. What's the date?
It'll be the grand opening, September 30th, which actually happens to be my birthday.
Yay! So come to the grand opening and bear gifts. And this episode specifically, if you want to comment on the YouTube thing, we'll hop in there and comment back and forth. Obviously, opt in our website, yourbizrocks.com.
And check us out on all the social media sites. We've got Facebook, we've got Twitter and Pinterest, and you can check out our stuff there. And we've got some cool little fun stuff also. And then join us again where we rock your biz.
Bye.
Bye.
Hey, welcome to this week's Expert Minute. This is me, June, again, and I'm reviewing Switch by the Heath brothers, Chip Heath and Dan Heath. And man, this book, I love this book so much. I actually went to a conference these guys were speaking on about a year before this book came out, and they just gave out what they call a galley copy, which is no cover, it hasn't been edited yet fully. And I just love the book. And then when it actually finally came out, I pre-ordered like 5-10 copies and gave them out to friends and stuff. mostly for anyone that's trying to change things, either in a nonprofit world or in a huge company, or you know, for my friends, they're educators. And just the story behind the authors themselves is actually pretty inspirational to me, in that they both got put on the map because they wrote a book called Made to Stick, which was a follow-up to Malcolm Gladwell's Tipping Point. The whole point of Tipping Point is something needs to be sticky, and ideas need to be sticky in order to create a tipping point. So they asked Malcolm Gladwell, you know, how do you make an idea stick? And he's like, well, there's all this research behind it. And they're like, well, you should write another book about it. And Gladwell said, I'm not interested, but here's all my research, and I'll write an introduction for you. Why don't you guys write a book? So they wrote a book called Made to Stick, and you can tell they weren't that excited about it. It actually put them on the map. It made them a contributing columnist to Fast Company, the great marketing magazine out there. But you can tell when they did the presentation for Switch, this is the book that both of them, they're both professors, that this is the book that they wanted to write all along. Like, they didn't want to be known for necessarily Made to Stick. That wasn't like their big touring thing. They didn't want to be associated with that necessarily. They're not ashamed of it, but that's not the book that, you know, was kind of the book inside of them. So the story behind Switch is, you know, this is how do you create change. It says, how to change things when change is hard. And so this is just a brilliant thing, either for yourself or a large organization, or maybe you're a small company, but you just have a very ingrained culture and you want to break out of that. The question is, how do you switch? How do you improve? How do you get better when changing things is obviously pretty hard? So just the story behind it is very inspiring. One of the surprising things in the book is how they treat data. They use these, you know, interesting stories about people making significant and magnanimous changes in all these really crazy, crazy environments. Like, one case study they use is a guy trying to combat malnourishment in Vietnam, you know, after the war, and was sent there by the UN. And I'm a science guy, so I tend to like data. I want as much data as possible. But in this one particular story, the thing that surprised me is this researcher said, you know, we're doing all this research trying to find out all this information, and his research team comes back with just pages and pages of information. He said, this is all TBU. This is all, you know, true but useless information. It's great that you can tell me that these villages are this poor or this is the food source, but this is not helping us solve our problem. Instead, he said he went back and he told them to look for what they called bright spots. And he said, with all the things being the way they are, they're true but useless, that data is not going to help us find a solution. So with things being the way they are, go find me some villages, or go find me places where the solution we're looking for is happening almost by accident. And let's start studying these bright spots where what we want to see happen is actually happening, even among all this, you know, bad situation. So the business analogy would be, in your company, you know, maybe there's some things that you don't like about your company, but even with all the conditions not being the way ideal, the way you want them to, what aspects of your business are going exactly the way you want them to? They're doing, you know, stellar work. They're hitting the ball out of the park. It's A-plus stuff. Maybe it's a staff person, or maybe it's a certain process or a certain area. Maybe your marketing is great, your sales isn't so good, or vice versa, or your operations are awesome, whatever. What is the bright spot in your company? And take a look at it, and what can you learn about that? You know, maybe it's your customer base. Like, you're shooting for four customers, and three of them are not going so hot, but with one customer, type of customer, doing a really great job, that's your bright spot. So you take a look at that and go, what about that is working so great that now we can learn from that instance and start to have that kind of a color and mess with the rest of we do anything? So that obviously is something that I've changed in my business. I'm such a data hound and a you know, an information fiend, that I like to have as much information as possible. But now, whenever I see information, I'm sifting through it for, okay, this information is fine if we're just doing like a book report or like a research project, but what information is actually useful? What can we execute on? And really what you're looking for is, and what then, you know, in my business, the improvements we're trying to make, what are the things that are actually working, that are going well? And then how do we let that then influence the rest of our business and the rest of our culture, the rest of our staff? So I strongly recommend this. You know, it's been out for a while now, so you can probably even find it in discount bins or whatever, but obviously you can download it on your Kindle like I like to do. Switch by Chip Heath and Dan Heath. And that's this week's Expert Minute. Hope you enjoyed it. Bye. Hey, welcome to this week's Viewer Mail, where Christine and I get one chance, and 1.75 chances to answer your most pressing business questions. So this week's question is a great question. Mandy from Grand Rapids, Michigan. I'm not getting a lot of referrals. What can I do?
Oh, this is a good question.
Great. One really smart question to be asking. You should always be thinking this in your business.
Because I will tell you this, referrals are my favorite clients, because they were already pre-sold when that person referred them to
us. All you can do is botch it at that point. No. It's your ball to drop, basically.
So we've done a couple couple of different things, and it's really unique what actually ended up working. So we would give a month with social media. We were like, okay, we're going to give you a whole free month. If you refer another business owner, they sign up with us, we're going to give you a whole free month. I mean, this was anywhere from $500 to $1,500 worth of, you know, free, and nobody cared. And I'm like, that is so weird to me. And so anyways, then we changed it up. Okay, you get a free iPad. Again, $500 value. Right. Free iPad. And then what do you know, we started getting all these referrals.
So weird, right?
Because it was something, and I finally figured out the logic behind it. It was something that they wouldn't buy. These business owners, it's not very exciting for them to get a credit on, you know, their business expenses. I mean, yeah, it's great, it helps, but they don't view it as anything exciting. So, but when it was an actual item that they wouldn't probably spend for themselves, you know, an iPad's like a toy, and you know, but they probably wouldn't go and spend $500 on one, then it was like exciting. Like, yeah, I want an iPad.
Yeah.
So.
Actually, I mean, so just to piggyback off of that, there's all these really interesting research studies when they talk about credit card reward programs. And it basically divides among like income levels. So lower income people, they wanted like cash back. That's what they wanted in their credit card reward systems. But after a certain income level, what they wanted were like luxury items that they were going to have a hard time justifying buying on their own. Oh. But if it came as a reward, they were all over it. They needed to spend $20,000 to get a free cruise and say, hey, I got it for free. You know, it's a free 7-day cruise. Like, well, you spent $20,000. But it was $20,000 that they could rationalize spending anyways. So it's a really interesting psychological thing. I would say, Mandy, one of the things that we see a lot with clients that don't get a lot of referral business is, one, a lot of people don't know what they do. You know, or they express it in such an incredible way, like not very credible, that people are like, ah, you don't even sound excited about what you're doing, or it's so obnoxious or whatnot. But a lot of it, I think I will always go back to the strategic part of it is, do you actually have a referral program strategy? Like how you're getting in front of your past clients, past customers? Are you even like, do you have a system in place, a process? Christine, I love process. Do you have a process that basically says, when someone sends me a referral, I send them a thank you card and a Starbucks gift card, because they, just to say thank you, you know. I typically don't like to do things where someone's like, hey, June, if I send you a referral, how much are you going to give me back? I tend to shy away from that kind of stuff. But when someone sends me a referral, I want to make sure that I amplify their, you know, kindness towards me by saying thank you back, you know. That sheer act of thank you, that's like why Oprah canceled her book club for so many years, because all these authors are becoming multimillionaires. And no one ever like busted out a phone call or a note to say thank you.
Really?
So she got so bitter. She said, you know what? I've changed these people's lives forever. I mean, multi-$1 million, it's like you're changing the course of their family history like forever.
And wait, that's why she stopped?
She stopped it for about a period of like, I think like 4 or 5 years.
Wow.
She was so bitter, which is, you wouldn't think that of Oprah.
Interview her? How do you know that? She admitted that?
No. It was one of her producers. And she was just saying like, it's so un-Oprah-like. The rest of her team was like, I can't believe, Oprah, that you would be so petty. She's like, listen, I understand when you become a multimillionaire from nothing, your life changes and stuff. But after about a year or two, like, shouldn't you remember why you became a multimillionaire or something like that? That's actually why, remember that one guy that caught lying on a million little pieces or something like that? She did something that's very un-Oprah-like. She brought him on TV and basically spanked him, right?
Yeah.
But it's so interesting. She regretted that interaction, so that one of her last 30 episodes was specifically to, she didn't quite say sorry. Oprah doesn't actually say sorry if you think about it. She never actually says sorry. She says, like, I'm sorry that was interpreted that way. Or it's like a half kind of sorry. But she had a whole episode just with him, with a new book he was coming out to help him again. But it was basically because she just felt it was so out of character for her to do that, because that was a sore spot with her in the first place, that all these authors are becoming multimillionaires and not saying thank you. You know?
Yeah, I have one vendor right now that's been with me for about 5 or 6 years, and I've referred so many people to this person. And she's never once thanked me, and I'm about to like cut it.
Yeah, after a while, you're like, wow. Who? I mean,
like, how do you not just shoot a quick email, Christine? Thanks,
man.
So
not
much.
Even an email to I say mean, thank you.
No, and I know, and this is a big ticket item, right? Yeah. And so, yeah, it's recurring. So,
you know, so Mandy, so one of the things we always look at, like, you know, when a client says we're not getting referrals, we dissect it. Do you have a strategy? Do you have a process in place? And a lot of it's like, oh, this one person actually did send us referrals and we never said thank you. Like, well, that one's gone.
Yeah, they won't refer anymore.
You know, they might, you can still probably save it depending where you are, Mandy, but hopefully that helped. And obviously, you know, interact with us on YouTube or send us more questions, and we'd be happy to talk more about this. Yeah. We get a lot more questions about this, we'll make it a whole episode.
Cool. Sounds good.
So hopefully that helps, Mandy from Michigan, and we'll see you next week.